the big guns look to duel at the Demon. The track at Champions reopens after a long layoff. We take the white flag with one of the young guns in Montgomery County.
Okay, follow the bouncing tire. One, two, three.
And she's off.
Hey.
This is Race Pro Weekly.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Race Pro Weekly. I'm Mike Warren. Brewerton Speedway had their big weekend in the month of September with the duel at the Demon. While the Saturday night program was canceled due to rain, we still got some stuff done on Friday as we head to some big block modified action. 50 laps for the Friday night field, and holy hieroglyphic, Batman's on the pole as he takes the lead up into turn number 1 and 2. Chuck Bauer going to follow him looking for the number 2 spot as the Genoa Giant Pat Ward going to work his way through turn number 3 and 4, trying to pick up a couple of positions as they come around to click off lap number 1. Chris Isle get a little out of shape through turn number 3 and 4, gets right into the 9H of Matt Shepard, who has to take evasive action. Hold on to that 9H here as we move towards the end of this event, but meanwhile, Britain way up in front as Brett Hearn and Vic Coffey battle, and what a three-car battle for the lead as the Sweeteners Plus car number 32C seeing a resurgence here in the late part of the season as he looks to go for the race lead on the 21A machine. Hearn right there lurking behind him, but here's Coffey to the inside as he bring it through turn number 3 and 4, and Vic Coffey driving it like he stole it on the inside lane, but Britton still too strong. Coffee would fade a little bit, and here comes the 98H of Jimmy Phelps on the inside looking to take the race lead away from Britton, digging down to the inside while Larry White and Matt Shepard fight side by side behind him for spot number 3. Shepard roll into the number 3 spot and get by White as White trying to battle back, but Shepard very strong on the inside lane. And now it's going to be Britton caught between an HBR sandwich through turn number 3 and 4 as Jimmy Phelps rides a cushion hard, and he take the race lead away down the front stretch. Matt Shepard would then battle on the outside as he saw the same lane Phelps used, and he would push around the corner off of 4 and look to take the lead, and he does. The FX Caprera car number 9H back to the lead. However, the 98H of Phelps going to move to the inside trying to battle with him back, but sooner than later you're going to see the 91 of Billy Decker come up looking to take the number 2 spot away from Phelps, and what a battle that was for the runner-up spot. However, Matt Shepard would continue to hold on to this race lead as Phelps and Decker continue to battle. Shepard, as I mentioned, way out in front of this one as he takes night number 1 of the duel at the Demon. The Franklin Flyer, Billy Decker, would come home in second. Jimmy Phelps would finish in third. Chuck Bauer fourth. And Vic Coffey would round out the top 5. With Fonda being on the shelf due to the Fonda Fair, Matt DiLorenzo and crew were back in action last Saturday night with a 40-lap, $4,000 to win modified main in memory of Ed and Michael Kaiser. A.J. Romano going to unfortunately end his career after next week. 33 years of greatness, and boy, is it going to be tough not seeing that orange number 16 on the speedway. 40 laps for the Mods, as it would be Jeremy Wilder leading the field up through turn number 1 and 2 for the first time, but the Palmer Service Center car number 2, R.J. Ronnie Johnson, going to power it to the outside as he would take the race lead away through turn number 3 and 4. Brett Haas and Al Palmer side-by-side. Danny Farron right there as well as they come down into turn number 3 and 4. Your leaders, here's Jeremy Wilder leaning on the 2RJ a little bit. And the wild child, as Jim King calls him, will move to the inside. Meanwhile, the 2RJ of Ronnie Johnson trying to hold off Mark Kislowski for position as they come down the back straightaway. As now Danny Farron and Darwin Green battle. But as that happens, Ronnie Johnson with trouble as he slows off of turn number 3 and 4. Off the restart, Kislowski and A.J. Romano fighting for the number 2 spot as Brian Berger and Dylan Scribner sit right in front of him. Romano hip checks him a little bit off the corner, but Kislowski holds on to that spot. Now Danny Barron with a slide underneath the 76 of Alton Palmer as he would take that spot away and drag race down the backstretch. Darwin Green still on the move, but then Palmer gets caught out of control up in turn number 1 and 2, flips the car. He would be okay, but a rough ride for the 76 of Palmer. Brett Haas also involved, as Palmer taking an unfortunate exit from the racing event. Off the restart, Jeremy Wilder going to fire off a turn number 3 and 4 and look to take the race lead, but Race officials deemed that he fired a little too early, and that would penalize him to go back a row, as that would move Danny Vairant up ahead of him on the next restart. So Mark Keselowski, off the drop of the green, would look to take over, and he'd take the spot away. While they're working on Romano, strong for the number two spot as Danny Vairant and Darwin Green go side by side. Romano holding on to that number two spot as Wilder looking to crank it up a little bit in the closing stages of this feature event, trying to run him down. That Darwin Green out of nowhere going to make his way up the outside as he brings it through turn number three and four. He'll pull into the number three spot and now try to go to work to chase down Romano. Danny Vairant looking to get by Wilder as well, but Mark Keselowski way out in front takes the Morris Auto Group car to victory lane. Mark Keselowski picks up a $4,000 hefty payday. AJ Romano would finish in second. Darwin Green with a great finish coming home in third. Jeremy Wilder fourth. And Danny Vairant would finish in fifth.
It's now time for this week's Recovery Sports Grill fan poll question. Who's going to win the Mohawk Valley 100 Super Dirt Series race at Fonda this weekend? Log on to our Facebook page at facebook.com/RacePro Weekly to cast your answer and let us know what you think. Last week we asked you, should the headline class on a given night at your local track be the final event of that evening, or should the features be switched up weekly? Matt said, honestly, I prefer big blocks not be the final event at my local track. Getting out is difficult enough as it is. Leave it alone. Daniel said, I think the headliner should go last. Some of my fondest memories were going to the track and into the pits and getting to see the mod feature winner surrounded by his crew on the front stretch at Lebanon Valley. Gail said, I like to have it mixed up a bit. Kevin said, switch it every week. And Bill said, the headline division was always last at Flemington Speedway. Promoter wouldn't have had it any other way. Coming up on Race Pro Weekly, we check in at Glen Ridge where the Big Locks put on one whale of a show, and we take a look at the Sportsman division at Albany-Saratoga, who ran a 50-lap season finale. The end of the race will leave you on the edge of your seat. Race Pro Weekly will be right back.
Reputable. Reliable. Results. That's what you get when you call Rick and the professionals at RCT Roofing. Quality service at fair prices. RCT gets the job done. Just like Nick Stone and the RCT Pro Stock. RCT Roofing. We've got you covered.
If you're like me, your to-do list never ends. But with just one phone call, I protect my home, family, pets, and yard all year round. With Northeast Pest Control's Premier Home Protection Program, I don't have to worry about bugs and pests, and I don't have to worry about harsh chemicals either. Now, how about that want to-do list? Thanks, Northeast Pest Control.
Ants, termites, mice, or bees, call today for your free estimate.
With Northeast Pest Control, we guarantee you'll live pest-free.
What makes the Outlaw 200 at Fulton Speedway one of Dirt Modified Racing's great races? It's the 30 years of tradition. It's the action, the drivers, and the fans. It's the drama of short track racing. It's the 30th annual Sunoco Fulton Ethanol Facility 200, presented by SUNY Canton. Friday and Saturday, October 2nd and 3rd. Order your seats now. FultonSpeedway.com. Experience the Outlaw 200 for yourself.
There's only one place in the Capital Region for you to get the full racing action. Stop down at the Bobco video booth at the track or call 518-399-0937. Bobco Racing Video, the next best thing to being there. With the unfortunate announcement a couple of weeks ago that this would be the final event at the New York State Fairgrounds for Super Dirt Week, we take a look back to some milestones from past Super Dirt Week action.
This car is doing the same thing, not handling as well as it was. Here we go onto the last lap, headed down into turn number one. Is Brad Hearn, does he have enough fuel to go 3/4 of a mile? We're going to find out. The crew just praying, just hoping that that car is going to make it work.
They know he's running on fumes. He told them on the radio that he's concerned. McCready, of course, driving hard. He's got plenty of fuel as they head down into turn number three. It is still Hearn right behind him. Johnson and McCready making one final bid as they come out of the final straightaway.
Jack Johnson goes low, one final shot. It is not enough. Brad Hearn, number 20, the youngster from New Jersey has won the Schaefer 200. And in this part of the country, Rob Gage, that makes you an instant legend.
Right, Steve, and it's just about like winning the lottery as well, as he'll take home over $50,000.
Rock with the winner.
Incredible mob scene down here. Everybody's gone. Brett, did you just run out of gas?
We just ran out of gas coming down off of turn four.
You were worried about fuel. The crew sat for quite a while.
With 10 laps to go, I couldn't tell if it was running out of fuel or if we had carburetor trouble, but it started sputtering with 10 to go.
Fantastic effort. Beautiful.
I can't believe it.
All right. What a show by Brett Hearn. A victory here. Okay, let's go to Steve.
All right. Thank you, Jack. You know, I said earlier Brett Hearn was popular. Look at this. Up on top of his race car at the finish line. What a celebration.
With the Fonda Speedway getting back in action this past weekend, Pete Demetrazic switched back to Friday night, and the Modifieds were back in action at Glen Ridge once again. CRSA Sprint Cars also on hand before the feature event, as Josh Flint would set the track record for a sprint car up on the ridge, as it would be Willie Decker and the 23 of Jeff Shealy right there. Jeremy Wilder will move into the number two spot very early into this competition, as Jim Nagel and Sean Pangman run wheel to wheel down the front straightaway and up into turn number one and two. Ricky Davis looking to make his way up along with the double zero of Bobby Vetter, as he put the electric slide job on the 53 of Bobby Vetter for position. Shealy doing his best job to try to get around Sean Pangman as something goes amiss on the Decker machine, which would hand the lead to the 24 of Jeremy Wilder. Off the restart cars will continue to ride, as now Bobby Vetter trying to work his way up into the top two as he sees Jeff Shealy right in front of him. He'd get by him and now go to work on Sean Pangman, as Craig Hansen looking to work his way back up through the field. Wilder, who inherited the lead as Decker had the issues, was continuing to lead this one, as issues would then plague the 34 of Sean Pangman, as now Craig Hansen would move to the inside lane of Jeff Shealy, trying to take that spot away. He would do it. Bobby Vetter working his way back up through the field as well. He'd go to the inside of Shealy, trying to take the spot away. Some great side-by-side racing at the ridge, as now Bobby Vetter with a love tap on the left quarter panel of Jim Nagel, and now three wide down the back straightaway. Jeremy Wilder doing a great job, and Shealy gets into the outside wall hard and goes into the pit entrance. A tough night for him. Then off the restart, Bobby Vetter gets tagged. He'd go around. Sean Pangman nowhere to go on the road's car number 34 machine. And then off the restart, as Vetter would get pushed back into the pit area. Now going back to this restart, Vetter must have thought it was Nagel or something, as he gets right into the back bumper of him and turns him around up through turn number one and two, as that would bring out the caution once again. Off the restart, Jeremy Wilder would continue to lead this one, as he has Vetter and Hansen in tow. Hansen would get by Vetter for the number two spot, as Wilder continuing to hold on to this one. Vetter ducking to the left side. That's the inside for those of you scoring at home. All behind Jeremy Wilder as he picks up the win at the ridge. Wilder goes for the victory. Hansen would finish in second. Bobby Vetter third. Sean Pangman fourth. And Ricky Davis would round out the top five. The 50-lap Sportsman Finale at the Albany-Saratoga Speedway, as Lunchbox Chad Edwards would lead the field to the green. In the Nazi Construction entry, along with Jason Gray up there on the top side, three-wide battle between Adam Gage, David Schilling, and Joe Orlando for position about midway through the pack, as Schilling would be the benefactor of that battle. Gage would get into the quarter panel of the 33 of Cody Oaks, sending him around for the one of many cautions early in this event. Cars will continue to ride as Jeremy Pitts and Tim Hartman Jr. would look to make their way up through the field on the inside lane, as now Gray would challenge Edwards for the number one spot through turn number three and four, as he barreled off the cushion. He'd be your new race leader here as we head to the quarter point of the event. Down the back stretch they would go. Derek McGrew going to run into the top five for the first time here in this one, and as the 2015 champ pulls right in behind Chad Edwards. A lot of close quarter racing through turn number one and two, and this was a great event for the 50 laps that it was, as McGrew with about 20 to go going to slide in front of the 14 of Chad Edwards on the inside lane and set his sights on the double zero. Tim Hartman and David Schilling continuing to make their way up through the field as they set just outside the top five at this point in the event. And one of the hottest drivers in Sportsman Division, Jeremy Pitts, going to look to make his way up through the field, trying to capitalize on his momentum he's found here at the end of the season as he looks to run down McGrew. Josh Sun putting some pressure on the 14 of Chad Edwards as he looked to get by him, but Jason Gray now having to hold on to a new challenger, as here comes Derek McGrew in the final 10 laps of this one, looking to make a strong move. He'd power to the inside of the CW Auctioneers car number 00 down the back stretch as McGrew and Ray would battle side by side for the race lead as McGrew trying to push to the inside. That time, Gray too strong on the outside. This time, they'd be coming to the white flag side by side, and Gray would grab the momentum off of turn number 4, and he'd be your leader. However, as they pushed up into turn number 1 and 2, Gray gets a little too high into the loose stuff, and that's all Derek McGrew was going to need as he take the race lead away and finish off the season with a 50-lap victory. Jason Gray would finish in second, Jeremy Pitts third, Josh Sun fourth, and Tim Hartman Jr. would finish in fifth. The Pro Stocks were also on hand on Sunday afternoon for their Championship 25 race, and Jeff Clemens sighting on the inside there. Meanwhile, down the back straightaway, things would get going early. Rob Yetman and Nick Stone would be on the move, along with the 14 of Kim Duell, as Jocelyn Watt would come around and be your race leader as they completed lap number 1. A few other cars in the field, of course, Sheldon Martin with one of his few races of the season in the Pro Stocks, as a little bit of attrition early as some of the heavy hitters being knocked out. Pete Stefanski alongside the 315 of John Ruthier and the 715 of Gus Hallner on pit road as they tried to fix their problems, but they would not be able to gather it back up. Meanwhile, Rob Yetman would make a bid for the race lead on the inside of Jocelyn Waugh, who was the pole sitter in this event in the early going. But the manimal, Nick Stone, would be right there as well as he would make a push to the outside lane off of turn number 2 and look to take the number 2 spot away from Yetman. Stone would look to take the position down the back straightaway as he would push to the outside and into the number 2 spot as he would look to run down Jocelyn Waugh. Stone would be right on his back bumper. Yetman still sitting back in there in third, and here comes the pass for the race lead as Stone would move to the inside of Waugh and take the position away as he would be your new race leader. Nick Stone, one of the winningest drivers in the Pro Stock division in the Capital Region this year, with the race lead, but Rob Yetman was coming as he would move to the inside of Wad. He'd take the number 2 spot away. It wouldn't be long before the Los Arrows Autobody car number 7 would make the move to the outside lane down the front straightaway as he would look to push to the outside, and as they headed up into turn number 1 and 2, Rob Yetman would be your new race leader. Sheldon Martin looking to find his way up through the field to gain a few more spots towards the end of this one as the 7 of Rob Yetman would continue to pull away as he would hold on to go back to back at the Moody Mile. Rob Yetman picking up the victory. Glenn Forward would finish in second. Nick Stone would have to settle for third. Chucky Dombluski fourth. And Francois Adam would round out the top 5. Other notable drivers, the pole sitter Jocelyn Watt would come home in 7th. Dean Charbonneau, the outside pole sitter, would be 9th. Jason Casey coming home 13th. Tom Harkins, who won the Futures race on Friday afternoon, would finish 24th. And Kim Duell would finish in 31st.
When Race Pro Weekly returns, we head back to the D-shaped Dirt Demon for some great sportsman action, and we check in at Fonda one more time for some full-size sprint car action. It's all coming up next on Race Pro Weekly.
Some of the music you've heard on Race Pro Weekly this week is by AJ Jansen, country's Rebel Rose, bringing you a mixture of high-energy rock and sultry country roots. To hear more and for your free download, check out ajjansenmusic.com.
Looking for outstanding service for your car, truck, or SUV? Speed's Garage is a family-run business providing the highest quality of auto care, from routine maintenance, brakes, engine, body, or paintwork. You can trust the professionals at Speed's Garage. Speed's Garage has all the auto service you need, plus full towing for any vehicle. For a championship service, go to Speed's Garage in Mellonville.
Performance. Quality. Service. That's DMC Racing Products. Hundreds of name brand parts. Competitive prices. That's DMC. DMC Racing Products. Race to win. Welcome back to Race Pro Weekly as we go to some sportsman action at the Brewerton Speedway and the Page Trucking car number 1, a Dave Marcacilli, to the race lead early in this event. Todd Root going to follow him in the 15 right behind him, as this would be a battle for the ages. They would be deep in lap traffic very early in this event, as now the 15 of Root going to dig to the inside, but Marcacilli is strong, as now they have some slower traffic in front of them. Marcacilli going to pacefully make his way into turn number three as the lap car goes high. And then here comes James Michael Friesen, looking to make this one interesting as he moves into the number three spot. He would dig to the inside of Todd Root as you see him go up into turn number one and two this time. This would allow Marcuccilli to get a little separation as Ron Davis III and Jack Meeks make their way up into the top five. Meanwhile, still battling through slower traffic, Root with another shot at him, but Marcuccilli way too strong in this one as he grabbed the win. Dave Marcuccilli picking up the victory. Todd Root to finish in second. James Michael Fries in third. Ronnie Davis fourth. And Jack Meeks would round out the top five. Back to the track of champions we go. We start you off with the start of the Sportsman feature as Cody Blue would lead the field to the green, but cars would come together coming down the front straightaway. Harry Schaefer goes up and over, and a number of cars getting together. A tough break for a lot of drivers in this, and that would postpone the Sportsman feature, and that will be continued this coming Saturday night as a part of Mohawk Valley Weekend. To the Pro Stock feature event now, the 322 of Jay Casey would be your early pole sitter in the final tune-up before the Hondo Classic this coming weekend, and it would be Casey out in front. Chucky Dombluski working on the outside of Chad Arsenault for position. Todd Hoffman in there along with Pete Broderson, Brandon Amey, and Jimmy Normoyle as well, heading down the back straightaway looking for position. Car on the move on the outside would be the 35 of Kenny Gates, one of the co-champions here in the 2015 season at the Track of Champions. So he would ride by Jason Casey. Nick Stone going to be up on the move as well on the inside lane as the 04 of Arsenal scurries to the outside. Meanwhile, Gates would continue his momentum, working for second on Chucky Dombluski, trying to make the move to the inside lane for second. But here's Dombluski on the outside, battling right back. Jason Casey right there, Nick Stone lurking behind them all as Kenny Gates trying to make his way to the front. I mentioned he was co-champion with him before. Here's Pete Broderson up on the outside lane looking to take spot number three away down the front stretch, and a great three-wide battle. Nick Stone gonna hang it into the inside and look to make it work as Jay Casey leads a pack of six cars down the back straightaway. That's six for those of you scoring at home. As Nick Stone would make the move to the inside, and now he would look to chase down both Kenny Gates and Jay Casey. Casey would hold on to this one, but that time Stone would barrel to the inside and go off the inside tires. That would move Kenny Gates to get momentum on the outside. He'd be your new race leader. Stone would follow him on the outside here, and just a handful to go. Nick Stone right on the back bumper. Stone going to look to try to make it work as they head down the back straightaway. He pulled right up on the back bumper of him. He carried through turn number three and four. Looked to pass him on the outside, but Gates says, "I don't think so, buddy," as Kenny Gates going to pick up the win. Kenny Gates with the feature event victory. Nick Stone will have to settle for second. Jay Casey third, Pete Broderson fourth, and Chucky Dombluski would round out the top five. Back to the Ridge we go for some Sportsman action, as it would be Bobby Hackle and Happy Harry Schaefer leading the field to the green in this $1,000 to win event for the Sportsman cars. Is Schaefer with the light on, going to bring it over around and click off lap number one as your race leader, as cars continue to make their way up through the speedway. The 79 of Brian Pesolano in there along with AJ Philbeck. Mark Mortensen looking to make his way up through the field as well in the early going. Here's Rocky Warner ducking underneath the 21L of Alyssa Cody, looking for a position as the Squirrel, fresh off the Northeast Great Nationals, looking to make things happen here in this event. Bobby Hackle driving to the inside of the 21 of Schaefer for position, as Warner will continue to drive up through the racing surface as he would go to the inside of the 79 of Pesolano, then go to work on the 54 of Curtis Hohenschelt as he continued to pick up cars one by one in this event. Happy Harry way out in front of this one as he would get through lap traffic, as the 53 of Doug Hancock would be right in front of him. As you can see, Hackle still sitting in second. Hackle, though, going to have a little bit of trouble here as he would try to get by Hancock. He'd miscue a little bit through turn number two, get into the quarter panel, which sent him into the implement tire, and that would be a tough break for the Full Throttle RC car number 97. As you see, Hackle with a little bit of damage coming down on the right rear of the car. Off the restart, Rocky Warner right on the back bumper of Harry Schaefer for the number one spot. Schaefer looking to hold on. Here's Squirrel going to go to the inside, as Rocky Warner would lose a little bit of ground, however. Constantino now up the third with Hohenschelt and Joslin right there, as Harry Schaefer would take home the win and the $1,000 prize. Happy Harry Schaefer picks up the victory. Rocky Warner with a strong second place finish. Dave Constantino third, Curtis Hohenschelt fourth, and Ivan Joslin would round out the top five. Other winners on the night, the Cruisers, it would be Cole Lawton and Josh Benizek would grab the win in the CRSA Sprints. CRSA Sprint cars at the Fonda Speedway as Joe Cotta will come around in heat race action to take the checkered flag. Of course, he's sporting Hallmar, which will be one of our sponsors for Super Dirt Week coming up in a couple of weeks. Here we go for the CRSA A main as Marshall Ken. That's Kenny Marshall for those of you scoring at home. Would send the field to the green as Mike Kaiser going to make the move on the outside lane early in this event as the cars would make their way through turn number one and two. Great move here as is going to be Warren Alexson looking to make a bid. Cody Flack in there as well as Thomas Rattaboy going to go hard into the outside wall just in front of the Cow Palace. As looks like his night will come to an end off the restart. Cars continuing to ride here in this one. The one of Corey Sparks trying to work his way around Josh Flint for position as they come down the front straightaway once again. As Goodrich trying to make his way up through the field as well. Kyle Smith to the inside now, going to take another spot away as they come down the front stretch as he would get by Christian Rumsey as Brian Crumble continues to lead this one way out in front in the number one car. Of course, Crumble having a great run going in a Sportsman car a week ago out at the Albany-Saratoga Speedway and looking to take his Capital Region skills back to power in this one as he would continue to lead this race. Brett Jaycox would power around the outside of the 91 to Chuck Alessius. Corey Sparks going to work his way back up through the field as he would split between the 91 and the 3A machine through turn number 3 and 4 as they come off the corner. Christian Rumsey looking to make his way up through the field on the inside lane as well as Crumble would have trouble on the outside of turn number 2, handing the lead over to Mike Kaiser and off the restart here with two laps to go. Cars scrambling as Cody Flack looking to make a move just like his brother would do to the inside lane. But this was all behind Mike Kaiser as he would grab the win in the CRSA A main at the Fonda Speedway. Mike Kaiser picking up the victory. Scott Goodrich will finish in second. Brett Jaycox third. Corey Sparks fourth. And Joe Cotta would round out the top five. Other winners on the night in the street stocks, it would be Josh Coonrad picking up the win. And in the limited sportsman, it would be John Stoll.
It's now time for this week's Berkshire County Network Driver Spotlight with 358 Modified Racer, Brett the Threat Haas. Race Pro Weekly is brought to you by Bob Hilbert Sportswear, Racing Electronics, Emmerich Associates, Tranquil Touch Healing, New England Racing Fuels and Sunoco Fuels. Coming up, Fast Eddie chats with a young driver who has run wild around the local tracks this year and will hand out our NISCA Performer of the Week. Race Pro Weekly will be right back.
I'm Brian from 1-800-GOT-JUNK. This is my main man, Tom, and my other main man, Tom.
You never know how much junk you've got until you move.
Point to something you wish would disappear.
Would it be possible to... It's gone!
All you have to do is point.
Where have you been all my life?
We make junk disappear. All you have to do is point.
The Choices 301 program takes a multifaceted approach aimed at educating the public about the realities and dangers of what can happen when bad decisions are made inside a motor vehicle. Don't hesitate to designate. Welcome back to Race Pro Weekly. This week in our White Flag segment, we head to Montgomery County, where one of the regulars who has been top-notch, that of course, the young gun, Jeremy Weitler.
Jeremy, we're coming to the close of the 2015 season. How would you rate your season?
I guess on a scale of 1 to 10, I would probably call it a 7, because there's definitely room for a lot of improvement, but it's been one of our better seasons. You know, last year was a good season for us with a win here, but we got two this year, and we just picked up another one last night at the Ridge with this car. I think a 7 is a good way to rate this season for me on a scale. Like I say, it still leaves a lot of room for improvement. There's a lot of things that we can improve on and I can improve on as a driver. So that's why I give it a 7.
I know you rated your season as a 7, but there was one night here where it caught on fire. Tell the fans what that's like when that happens inside the car.
It was definitely an adrenaline rush. You know, we were kind of, I guess it kind of startled me more than it did anything, because that night we come into turn 3 and it ended up being one of the float bowl plugs in the carburetor came out. And when the car laid over, that's when the fuel hit the header, and that's what ignited it. And initially, you know, it startled me because it came right up in the cockpit and everything. And then as I let off, you know, the fuel kind of slowed down. It went back in the car, or back behind, or in just the motor compartment. And, you know, we were kind of running mid-pack at that point. And, you know, not, it's you know, hard for other guys to realize what's going on. So I had a car on fire. I didn't want to wreck one, too. So I slowed down the best I could and got out of everybody's way and then got to the infield, you know. In a situation like that, you know, the first thing you want to do is get out, just get out. But, you know, you got to remember there are a lot of other guys out there on the racetrack with you that, you know, are having a pretty decent night. So I wanted to respect them guys and, you know, let them go. And we ended up getting out, you know, not too much damage done. We burned up an air filter, but, you know, overall it could have been a lot worse. Could have been a lot worse.
Who are some of the drivers that you look up to or can go to for advice?
You know, I got asked that question here a couple weeks ago, and we bought our first car when we started racing Sportsman from AJ Romano, and you know, he's always been good to me throughout the years. You know, we don't talk like we're best friends, but you know, he always says, you know, hi, you know, we always got along real good. You know, I guess it's tough for me, you know, because racing against the guys, you know, they see that I think we're progressing as a team, and so, you know, the questions and answers kind of seem to go by the wayside. But if I had to pick a driver, you know, that I look up to the most, I think it'd be AJ. And I, you know, I hear all this stuff about him moving away and, you know, all being done racing. And, you know, I think that's, you know, a pretty big deal. He's a good driver in our sport. You know, he's been around a long time, him and his family, Mike and Andy. You know, they're a great bunch of guys. I got a lot of respect for AJ, and it's, you know, it's a shame to see him go.
Who do you need to thank for getting you on track this season?
My car owner, Bill Schoons, you know, here, he puts a great piece together for me. The guys, you know, they make it easy for me. You know, I go down a few nights a week, we work on the car, we have a good time. You know, there's never any, you know, extra stuff that goes along with it. We like to race, we all like to have a good time, we do well, and, you know, that really helps. And, you know, as for the car that I run up to Glen Ridge, my 22 car, my parents, you know, it's the same deal there. I got a whole separate crew, but, you know, everybody's on the same page. You know, we're all hitting on all eight, and, you know, everybody's heart is in it. And, you know, I told the guys when we started this whole deal this year with the cars, and I says, if anybody's got other plans, you know, I don't expect their life to revolve around my racing. And, you know, as much as I told them that, and they're there week in and week out, and they bust their asses for me. They do a great job, and, you know, I'm thankful for every one of them.
It's now time for this week's NISCA Performer of the Week, and with his win in the Kaiser Memorial at Fonda for $4,000, it goes to Mark Kislowski. Kislowski is now eligible for the Performer of the Year award given out at the end of the season. That's all for this week's show. For the latest news, results, and photos, check out Race Pro Weekly online at www.raceproweekly.com, and be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. So for myself, Amber Chalmers, Fast Eddie, Scott Morlock, and everyone that helps put Race Pro Weekly together, thank you for watching this week's episode, and we'll see you next time.